Uddhava intervened with a question. He asked, "My Lord, you tell me that the Atman is free, that he is not bound by the play of the gunas and by the actions performed by the body and the sense organs. I am not able to grasp it. Realizing the truth about himself makes man free of his bondage is a lesson you are trying to teach me. When you say that man is free of his bondage, that statement assumes that there is a bondage of some kind which is tying him down. Tell me more about this freedom from bondage. Does man attain salvation when he is without the gunas, or even when they are present in him? If the gunas are not there in the makeup of man, how can he exist and how can he find a path to you? If freedom is attained even when the gunas are present, where then does the bondage come in? Please elucidate this for me. I have so far understood that the gunas are very present in man, but when a man refuses to identify himself with the gunas and their play, he is free and his bondage begins when he forgets his apartness. How is one to recognize an emancipated soul and one who is not? How does a man move in this world of men? And how does the other man, the ordinary man, behave? Tell me." Krishna said, "Uddhava, you do not have to go very far to find an answer to your question. Look at me. The gunas are caused because of my maya. I am the one who spreads the net of maya and the gunas in the world. But I have no bondage, and obviously I do not need to be freed of this bondage. The body with its attendant pleasures and pains are because of my maya. Like I said before, it is as unreal as the world of dreams to a sleeper awakened. Uddhava, remember, awareness as well as ignorance are both manifestations of my power. They are eternal, and they are the causes of freedom or bondage, as the case may be. Consider the moon in the sky. When there are several pools, ponds, eddies, little pots filled with water, this moon is reflected in all of them. When a breeze is rustling by, there is a wave of unrest passing across the surface of the water. The reflected moon trembles, and this trembling is apparent only in the reflected moon and not in the moon who is shining in the sky, serene and resplendent. Even so, the play of the gunas and the indriyas cause the Atman in you to allow itself to be moved by them. I will explain again. The sun is reflected in several pots of different shapes and different sizes. And the same sun is reflected in all of them, filled as they are with water. But then the moment one of them breaks and loses its identity, namely a large pot, a small pot, and so on, the image vanishes and becomes one with the sun above. This oneness happens when and only when the pot breaks. Even so, when man realizes that the feeling of I is false, the truth dawns on him immediately, and there is no more bondage for him. I will give you another analogy. On a peepal tree are living two birds. They have built their nests on the tree. One of them has its nest on the topmost branches of the tree, and he is happy, viewing the sky around him. The free air is all around him, and he does not need any food other than this joy. The other bird has built its nest not so high, but much lower down. He hunts for his food all day long, and all around him is found nothing but the shadow cast by the tree. The two birds have been greatly attached to each other. They had been like twins, each being the alter ego of the other. But the difference between the two has now sprung up because of the involvement of the one with its surroundings. The Vedantins compare the free bird to the emancipated soul, and the other bird to the man caught in the web of Maya. The bird on the topmost branch does not find any difference between himself and the other birds, but the other bird considers himself to be unhappy, that he is suffering and that he is indifferent from his one-time friend. The ignorant man who does not know that his Atman is the same as the Brahman is suffering from bondage, and the one who has realized this truth is considered to be free. When a man wakes up from sleep, he often remembers the dreams very vividly, but he is conscious that it was all unreal, and that it was just an illusion conjured up by the mind during sleep. He does not suffer the pangs of hunger because he was a beggar in the dream, nor does he walk about with arrogance and pride since he was a king in his dream. The ignorant man, the man suffering from bondage, is comparable to the man who is still dreaming. While dreaming, the dream seems very real to the dreamer, and to realize that it is all a dream, it is necessary for a man to wake up. Even so, man should wake up to the reality of Brahman. Then he will not be bound even though he walks about among the objects of the world. They do not move him or bind him down, since he knows that he is the Brahman, and these are but illusionary objects. The man who has learnt detachment can move in the world littered with the sense objects and yet be free from them, since they can hold no sway over him. He will realize that action wedded to the gunas, makes a man a slave, and so the really free man will be unattached even to small details like food, bathing, clothes, and similar things. He will be indifferent to all of them. His behavior when his life is concerned, when his senses are concerned, when his power of thinking is concerned, will all have no end in view, and so, even when he is living and moving with the others in the world of men, he will be free. If he is hurt bodily, he will not mind it, nor will he be elated when someone praises him. He will not praise or flatter those who do him good or speak well of him, nor will he condemn those who talk ill of him and who act wrongly. He will not be interested in doing either good or evil, since both of them look the same to him. His speech will have neither of these, and hence he will be considered to be stupid, but that will not in any way affect him. The Upanishads are defined as the Brahman captured by sound. I have seen men who have known the entire storehouse of the Upanishads, who are able to repeat it word for word, and who have still not been able to realize the Paramatman described therein. They are like cows which are incapable of yielding milk. Uddhava, let me assure you, in later times a man with a cow which cannot give milk, or a wife who does not love him, a body which is a constant source of different types of pain and aches, a son who is of no use to his father, or wealth which is not given to the deserving, all these, or any one of these, will make him heir to nothing but suffering on top of suffering. A man's wealth of learning may be immense, but it is not enough if it is just an accumulation of the learning of the Vedas and the Shastras, without being leavened by the stories of me and my avataras. Uddhava, I know that it is not easy to devote one's mind completely to me and to thoughts of me. Such a man can do karma yoga, meaning let him perform actions in the world, but let him not at any time desire the fruits of his actions. He should not expect rewards for his efforts. Let him act like this in the world of men, and let him think on me as often as he can, and he will soon become my bhakta, and he will reach me.